previous slide, but I'll be doing an entire review of past 100 years of what has been going on with this type 2 diabetes. So my title would be the history and present trends in this pathophysiology of type 2 diabetes mellitus. I'll start with the tribute to the discoverers of insulin. This is a centenary year, 1921. They have discovered this, and it's been 100 years this in 2021. And these were the four people involved with this. This is Banting, who is a physician and a scientist. This is McLeod, who is that time he was a professor of physiology, and he owned the lab. And Best was a lab assistant, and Collip was the biochemist. And the Collip is the least known, though he contributed to he is the key ingredient in this group, but he was the least known among the four. We always tell it as Banting and Best, and McLeod is also given the Nobel Prize. Banting and McLeod shared that. Okay. So this is the lab in Toronto in which he worked, the physiology lab, which belonged to McLeod, where Banting worked. And this one is the lab painting by Banting. Let me get the pointer. So this is a painting by Banting, which is sold for a large sum of money a couple of years ago. They auctioned it, and this entire thing went into diabetes research. And immediately the next year followed, following the discovery, they gave it to their first patient. This is Leonard Thompson. In 1922 January, they gave it to the patient, and immediately they shot a famous, worldwide famous celebrity they have become. So this is a newsprint from that March 20, 1922. Toronto doctors on track of diabetes cure. They have become a huge celebrity immediately. And the next year, they got the Nobel Prize. Usually there is a lot of waiting, but this was an important problem at that point of time, because type 1 diabetes was a terminal diagnosis at the time. People lived only for a few months, maximum a year after the diagnosis. So this was an important milestone, and they have improved the longevity very much. So they were given the next year itself, 1923, Banting and McLeod received the Nobel Prize. Though there were a lot of controversy around who should have got, but these two got the prize, and they shared with the rest of the team, the two people. So from this point off, I'll start from here, my presentation. My question is, what causes diabetes? That was I tried to understand based on this review. And let's start the journey. Since it's a story I'm going to tell you, I'll start with long, long ago. So long before the discovery, this people in different culture has already known this condition. And these descriptions, it's found all over the culture, everywhere some description is found, even 1,000 years back. And these terms, this is Hippocrates, in one of his literature, he used all these four terms. In a similar context, polyuria, polyphagia, polydipsia, and sweet urine, that was the cornerstone. All these things have been found in Hippocrates' description also. And I found that people even have some idea about the two group of patients. One is a young, lean patient who had a poor prognosis, died immediately after a few months after the diagnosis. And some patients who had this similar condition of polyuria, polyphagia, and sweet urine, but they were adult obese patients, they lived longer, they not so bad prognosis. So this was there even many hundred years before the insulin discovery. And I found that even in Greek and in ancient Egypt, they suggested calorie restriction and exercise as a treatment for diabetes. But when it comes to the pathophysiology, like, they were not in the right organ. Mostly it is some or other organ they were focused. They were not to the point. So we'll come closer to the discovery, a decade before discovery. A decade ago, in the 1910s, he was the most famous diabetologist, Frederick Madison Allen. He's the most famous diabetologist practicing in New York City. And what he does is that he does a calorie restriction to cure diabetes. And this is one of his book. This is not the original print. It's a reprint book. This is the cover of the reprint. And it is still even a valuable tool because he has meticulously noted many hundred patients of how he, what calorie restriction he did, how their blood profile and all improved. This he has meticulously documented. And he also noted that young lean patients have, you know, he prolonged life by few years, but obese patient responded better. And many of his patients died due to malnutrition, and it was a controversial figure also. And I also found that there are some in 1920 there is a publication which says use of a high fat diet in the treatment of diabetes mellitus. This is about 100 years before. They talked about low calorie diet, high fat diet, everything. But what happened the next year? Insulin was extracted, and this is the paper from Banting and the Best and the team. The effect produced on diabetes by the extract of pancreas, 1922. Once this paper is published, this all diet related people went bankrupt. Particularly this, he stopped practicing diabetes anymore. So he stopped even researching for diabetes. He shifted from diabetes to cancer research. That was the impact the insulin discovery had on him. So it was insulin from that point of time. So everybody was convinced insulin deficiency took the center stage of diabetes. And in the early 1900s, there are a lot of hormones being isolated, and hormone deficiency has become an accepted term. And there is insulin deficiency leads to diabetes. Everybody was convinced. There was no doubt about it. But in a few years when doctors started treating diabetes patient with insulin, they have found that not everybody is equally sensitive to insulin, which means some patient require more amount of insulin compared to the other. So there was a talk about insulin resistance, but this publication by Himsworth in 1936 was credited with the documented scientific evidence of showing that insulin sensitivity and insulin insensitivity. So what he did, this graph shows, he injected glucose and insulin together in patients. And he found that some patients, the blood glucose level dropped, the lower one, and some patients immediately it starts rising. So he found that the patients where the blood glucose dropped and did not rise much is the insulin sensitive group. And the other group of patients where immediately the glucose started rising, he termed as the insulin insensitive group. So from the insensitivity, the resistance term also become consolidated. Though in this publication, he used the insensitivity, but the term insulin resistance was there around in different publications in the 1930s. They found that there could be different types of diabetes. Of course, they were not named as type 1 and type 2 at that point of time. But now in the 1930s, as far as our type 2 diabetes is considered, this idea of insulin resistance was getting bigger and bigger. But though insulin insensitive, the liver was insensitive, the bodies, whatever they've understood at that point of time, they started giving more and more insulin as the treatment. So they did not see as a sign of some problem, but if it is insensitive, give supraphysiological doses, abnormal doses of insulin. They started giving from right that point of time. So that actually only damaged the situation, but they only found out much later. And this is what if one of the endocrinologists described this way, that if a receiver has malfunctioned, which means the telephone receiver is not picking sound in a sensitive way, but what we are doing is we have done shouting at the receiver using a loudspeaker. So that's what the insulin sensitivity and insulin treatment refer to. This is I found from an endocrinologist description. So coming back to the timeline, in a decade later, 1941, Banting died tragically due to an accident. And in 1945, Banting Memorial Lecture, this was given by Best, the same Charles Best, who was the lab assistant. Now he is the director of Banting and Best Department of Research and Department of Physiology in University of Toronto. He gives a lecture about what has happened before insulin and what they did during insulin and what he hopes for the future. He hoped two things at the end. He wanted to find a cure at least for newly diagnosed, they don't wanted to continue giving insulin to the people. He wanted them cure a permanent solution on how to prevent diabetes. These are the two new problems, and he called for the young scientist at that point of time to work on these two areas. But that's what he wished. But what has happened? What the opposite of what he wished. So this is the number and percentage of US population diagnosed with diabetes from 1950s to 2015. You can see it's skyrocketing. It's a slow pandemic, which did not receive so much attention as the pandemic of COVID-19. But it is slowly creeping on and gaining its traction. And this all happened after we discovered insulin. So what happened after this? What is the cause for diabetes? It's not insulin deficiency and resistance. There has to be something behind. So people, one thing which was coming up around that point of time in 1940s is that they started associating upper body obesity with diabetes and atherosclerosis. So he was credited with this android type of obesity. This is Gene Walk. He was the first person to use this association, that android obesity, upper body obesity is associated with increased risk of diabetes. Okay, now then the next question immediately would come is, what causes obesity? And the problem at that point of time, now I retrospectively think that what causes obesity, this answer was not clearly given, and there are a lot of misinformation from the nutritional research. I recently found that in 2016, there was a paper which showed how the sugar industry intervened the diabetic research and the atherosclerosis research. So this is a historical analysis of internal industry documents, which has been published. This is published in JAMA, and I found it everywhere. There are multiple articles around the same topic. That is, they leaked the sugar industry relevant documents from the 1960s recently. We got access to it. So one of the minutes of the meeting shows something like this. Some relevant document shows something like this. This is the president of something called International Sugar Research Foundation. This is the logo of Sugar Research Foundation. And this is the latest name for the association. It was originally called International Sugar Research. Now it is called just Sugar Association. They said if Americans could be persuaded to eat a lower fat diet for the sake of their health, they would need to replace that fat with something else, and America's per capita sugar consumption could go by a third. So they allegedly funded a Harvard research for about $20,000 or something they paid, and they influenced the research into thinking that eating high fat diet would cause a person to become obese, and obesity would cause diabetes. Like this even remains everywhere, isn't it? So in our subconscious process, we don't blame eating a lot of sugar for becoming obese or getting diabetes, but we blame fat. High intake of fat will cause obesity and diabetes, but high intake of sugar, okay, as far as you are normal, you can eat as much sugar you want. Sugar may not be related to getting diabetes. That's what is a common understanding developed, and it was propagated. And this is not only an isolated incident in 1960. Recently, before going to the recent incident, I wanted to show that we all know something called as a tobacco industry research committee, isn't it? So this was one of the famous committee who have been saying that smoking is not the major cause for lung cancer. So this is the 1960 presentation made before the Cancer Association by this Tobacco Industry Research Committee. In this a brief review of smoking lung cancer theory, they rejected that smoking causes lung cancer, and they said there is no evidence for this. So we all know about this tobacco industry research, isn't it? So we all think that similar thing happened. Maybe the sugar industry learned from tobacco industry. No, it was, I found that it was other way around, that the first thing was formed was the Sugar Research Foundation, and the first scientific officer was Robert Hackett. Then the TARC, when it is formed, he recruited Robert Hackett to do what has been done in the nutrition research, that is to help the tobacco industry learn key science manipulation and tactics from sugar industry. So this is what I found. And this is from publication. These are not my own words. All are documented somewhere other words. So from this publication, I found that they have a lot of associations similar to the tobacco industry, which has been refuting smoking. Is they continue to avoid ban for a long period of time. Ban on smoking from governmental organization was not allowed because of this committee. Similarly, this Sugar Research Foundation has influenced a lot of research on obesity and nutrition. And I found that this is not an isolated incident which happened at that point of time. In 2015, there was a group called as, there is a group, a Global Energy Balance Network. What they say is, it is the exercise which will decrease your obesity. So you focus more on your exercise. It's not the food. You eat more food, do more exercise. So just taking the focus away from the food in the obesity. So that's what their primary motto is. Guess who is funding that research and who at least caught funding. So this is from the news. I found that Coca-Cola company caught funding scientists who deflect the blame for obesity away from sugary drinks. So till now, for the past decades, there are a lot of research on nutrition. We all know that nutrition research is always not clear, isn't it? One day they will say cholesterol is the bad evil. And 2015, we know that cholesterol has been cited as many guidelines. The guidelines for limiting the cholesterol intake has been removed by many countries. We all know that. So nutrition are always being flipping, flopping about what we need to eat and what causes diabetes or what causes obesity. All these things are related to a lot of intervention by the corporate industries. Okay, so let's come back to the timeline again. We are in the 1960s now. WHO issues a classification for the first time how to classify diabetes. So this is what they could do their best. They just find the age, and again, everything was insulin centered. So childhood, young, adult, elderly, based on the age group, and they call diabetes at the end, the suffix, and everything is dependent again on insulin. And there was a category may or may not need insulin, but still they wanted to, you know, group it in one group. So everything was about insulin, whether may or may not require, but it's still insulin. That's what is the cornerstone of that age and insulin requirement, 1960s. In 1960s, one of the interesting theories which I found, which they tried to explain why diabetes could be there, why the prevalence of diabetes is increasing, it's called a thrifty genotype hypothesis. So the hypothesis said we all have thrifty genes which help us to utilize the resources, we process and utilize the energy we consume and store it very efficiently in our adipose tissue, so that it helps during the process of during the period of starvation and when there is lack of food. This was happened historically, isn't it? Like few hundred years back, the stable food supply was not available, so there is always periods of starvation and famine. So people with these thrifty genes had a good survival, and that's why now we have a continuous surplus of food. That's why we have a lot of diabetes, the obesity and diabetes that was proposed by James Neal. But this theory never took off because they could not identify specific genes and label them as thrifty gene. There was no single gene found. And it was took over later on by the thrifty phenotype hypothesis, also called Barker's hypothesis. He coined that it's the interaction with the environment and how the phenotype is being produced, not the genes itself. And the explanation came in terms of epigenetic changes. So this is also referred as thrifty epigenomic concept. And this is also referred as fetal origin hypothesis. This is because the maternal nutrition when the baby is intrauterine life will determine whether the baby develops obesity or diabetes in the future. The intrauterine growth retardation correlates with diabetes and obesity in the future. So there were a lot of evidences. So it's also called as fetal origin hypothesis. And eventually they have settled one name. So they have picked a name. Now they call themselves as DOHAD, Developmental Origin of Health and Disease. That they had a society and they have a journal. And this is a research area, not only relates to diabetes and metabolic syndrome, it goes beyond everything. So Now I'm going to stop again, go back to 1960 again. So we will drop this theory here and go back to the 1960s. One interesting development happened in 1960s is we found a way to measure plasma insulin. So far it was all about glucose. And finally, we found a way to measure accurately radioimmunoassay, which you can measure and depend on the value that it is reliable. And this is Rosalind Yalow, and she was awarded Nobel Prize in the next decade. And now we have two values, isn't it? One is the blood glucose level, and we also have plasma insulin. So what do? We plot both in a single graph, and we call it as HOMA, like homeostatic model assessment, where we plot where we find out insulin resistant and beta cell function. This is the first version, which was published in 1985, where we could quantify the insulin resistant and beta cell function in diabetic individuals. So in 1910, the blood glucose estimation was much more streamlined. And 1960s, we learned to measure plasma insulin. And a decade later, we plotted the chart and we called it HOMA. And in 1970s, in the same period, what I found was that there are a lot of research on diet. And many of the research, I found that they not only correlated with the glucose level and the cholesterol and triglyceride, hypertension, all of the things were affected by the calorie intake. So there was a lot of association found, and people were looking together as a common entity. And finally, they named it in some publication in 1977. Clearly, this is as a metabolic syndrome. Obesity, diabetes, and other things they have coined. But still, there was one thing not found clearly is what is the common factor behind them? The answer came a decade later, and this was Gerald Reven, who linked insulin resistance with the metabolic syndrome. So it's called as a Reven syndrome sometime also. He called it syndrome X, but we are sticking with metabolic syndrome. And insulin resistant, hyperinsulinemia, everything is related because of this insulin resistance and metabolic syndromes. So this he gave in a 1988 Banting lecture. The article which I forwarded you is 2012 Banting lecture. This was given by American Diabetes Association. They give the decade whoever done a important contribution to diabetes research. They give it this lecture as a to honor them. So this is 1988 Banting lecture. That's the first time he revealed this, that he is linking insulin resistant and metabolic syndrome. So this is syndrome X. In the 1980s, WHO has come up with a new classification. Again, it is insulin-centered, insulin-dependent, and non-insulin-dependent. Initially, they had this type 1 and type 2 also, but a couple of years later, they just dropped type 1 and type 2. And it came back later again, but immediately they dropped, and initially they did not think nobody used it. So they thought insulin dependent and non-insulin dependent, because the treatment and the understanding was focused fully on insulin. So that's how they classified 1980s. So I went on to find a review article which will explain me what was the understanding in 1980s. So I found a paper. This was written by Ralph A. DiFranco. He's an important person. He was the man behind FDA approval of metformin in the 1990s. So metformin was approved in the USA slightly later than many other countries. The research and everything was backed by him. Not only that, recently the SGLT2 inhibitors got FDA approval. Those work are also done by Ralph DiFranco. And so what he said in 1980s, again, he's sticking with these three. There is an impaired insulin secretion, the insulin deficiency. And the second is the insulin resistance. Now we have expanded into two different concepts. One is a skeletal muscle insulin resistance, which is a decreased glucose uptake, and hepatic glucose production, increased hepatic glucose production. This is the other form of insulin resistance. So these two has become the important cornerstone of what we understood in 1980s. Though the obesity was known and the relationship with the insulin resistant metabolic syndrome, everything was known. What causes which causes first, which, you know, at that point we had evidence for obesity having a genetic component, and insulin resistance also had a genetic component. Obesity also depending upon environment. Insulin resistance also depends upon not only the gene, the environmental interaction, and both causes aggravates each other. So now which comes first? That was one of the doubt, but people preferred obesity to come first at that point of time in 1980s. So in early 90s, it would be insulin resistant and beta cell dysfunction. This was the major pathological understanding of what happens in diabetes. In 1987, I found a paper which says, this is presented in the American Surgical Association. They have done the gastric bypass surgery for about 200 patients. They found that within 10 days, most of the patient, 95% of patient became euglycemic. Their blood sugar became normal. So before operation, they all needed insulin, oral agents, and after operation, very few required. These were about 200 patients. But what they did not think anything about calorie intake has been decreased or something. So the hypothesis they presented is there was something called as an anti-insulin, which is secreted from the duodenum when the carbohydrate reached there. So carbohydrate reaching the duodenum, so the islets will secrete insulin, but the duodenal cells could secrete something called as an anti-insulin, which would actually cause us the insulin resistance. So now we have bypassed that. No food goes there and food is going in a different track. So there is no problem. That's how they reverse diabetes. That's what they thought. But this procedure was invasive. Not many will easily take this thing. And people were searching for a different thing, like what is this anti-insulin and role of food reaching duodenum. So people were misdirected for a while. So otherwise, they have found that something, people could reverse the diabetes in 10 days, but which was not taken very well. In 1999, WHO releases a classification. Now they dropped their insulin dependency, IDDM and NADDM from the title. They call it type 1 and type 2 diabetes. This has beta cell restriction, and the type 2 has the insulin resistant and relative insulin deficiency. So this is how I called it. And in around 2000, if I go and look at a review, this shows metabolic syndrome pathogenesis like this. So everything would start with adiposity, which would cause the insulin resistance. And this causes the insulin hypersecretion, and hyperinsulinemia will lead to certain things. And this insulin resistance alone will increases the glucose level from, you know, the muscle and adipose tissue would not take much, and this leads to impaired glucose tolerance. And the glucose will affect the pancreatic cells, which we called glucotoxicity and lipotoxicity. Those terms came, and finally it progressed to arteriosclerosis. So this is what in 2000 a pathogenesis of metabolic syndrome looked like. And so if you find a good textbook around that point of time, this is what the understanding. Type 2 diabetes mellitus is chronic, inevitably progressive disease characterized by hyperglycemia, insulin resistant, and decrease in beta cell function. This is how it is defined. And there was a lot of studies which is done around this point. And one of these things is a UKPDA study. In that, they showed that it is inevitably progressive, means whatever drug you give, ultimately the disease process is going on. So the sense of a good control of your blood sugar level has nothing to do with the pathogenesis of the diabetes itself. It's progressing. This is the definition, but this does not give us a thing to work on. You know, like it's inevitably progressive. There is no drug to reverse this. And doctors have been telling patients that type 2 diabetes is, you are going to eat tablets for lifelong, face it. So patients would ask, is there any other way, can I reverse? Not much is offered, because the study showed it's inevitably progressive and chronic. In 2009, I'm coming back to the same guy, he's the Ralph DeFranco. Now he's working on SGLT2 inhibitors, getting approval for that. So now you can see there are multiple other components came into his, from triumvirate to amnes octet. So he has he has went into 3 to 8, and so you can see the kidneys. That's where our new drug is going to work. So that has been also in the pathogenesis now. At this point of time, there are a lot of research, I can say. Some people focusing on only on the adipose tissue, and adipose tissue is now considered as an endocrine organ by the time. Leptin, adiponectin, resistin, there are so many molecules which comes from adipose tissue, influences the rest of the metabolism. So there is one group, and there is the incretin was found after, you know, decades of search. Good. And there is a group which focuses on bacteria, microbacterium within the GI tract and GI immunity relating to diabetes, and the pancreatic cells and everywhere. Even the central nervous system has another important role to play, the receptors and how CNS controls blood sugar level, insulin secretion, and the hunger, satiety. There is a lot of explosive growth. Now, at this point of time, it is multiple things. There is no clear picture of what happens in diabetes. So from my perspective, I thought it was like that, like it's group of blind men describing elephant. So everybody is thinking, approaching this disease from a different point of view, and there was no unified answer for what causes diabetes. And in 2008, I'm coming closer to the paper which I have sent you all. So this is the one before. This is a randomized control trial where they took 60 obese patients and they did the gastric banding, and another group for conventional therapy, and they compared. They found that a large group of patients who undergone gastric banding has reversed the diabetes within a short period of time, like what we have seen in another publication in 1987, the surgery, the same bariatric surgery. This is the least invasive of all types, reversible thing. So this adjustable gastric banding reverses diabetes. So from this, our authors, the paper I sent to you, the major author is Roy Taylor. He picked up how the diabetes reversed in these patients. What happened? And from this reversal history, he traced the cue to cause. So first, what happened in the patients immediately after a bariatric surgery is that they went into negative calorie balance, and there was a decrease in liver fat. That was the first thing to decrease. Even before the patient lost a significant weight, overall liver fat decreased. Immediately the liver fat decreased, the hepatic glucose production was lower. So insulin was now able to control the glucose production. So the fasting hyperglycemia has vanished in thin few days after negative calorie balance. And in a few more days, the first phase response, that is glucose stimulated insulin secretion, was also improved. And even the postprandial glucose levels came down, and plasma triglyceride came down. This happened within weeks. Within a few weeks of negative calorie balance, everything reversed. So from that, they synthesized what could have happened in diabetes is years of positive energy balance. It could affect increasing deposition of liver fat, which is accelerated by the presence of insulin resistance, the skeletal muscle insulin resistance, which is genetically inherited, and most relatives of diabetes patients will have this skeletal muscle insulin resistance, which can be demonstrated decades before they get diabetes. So this positive calorie balance causes increase in liver fat deposition. Now liver has too much resources to handle. So liver starts synthesizing more triacylglycerol and more glucose. So there is a hypertriglyceridemia and hyperglycemia which happens. And this triacylglycerol, which is synthesized in the form of VLDL and sent to everywhere, gets deposited in all the organs. It deposits in the blood vessels, in the adipose tissue, and also in the pancreas. And in the pancreas, this islet cells are exposed to high level of fatty acids for months and years. And they initially secrete more amount of insulin, and eventually they stop responding to the glucose load. The first phase response is decreased. They are continuously secreting high level of insulin without any much of the first phase response. So this results in eventual hyperglycemia, and by the time the diabetes is diagnosed, it's a common understanding that about 50% of beta cell function is lost. So this has been known since past two decades from the longitudinal studies. So this is the natural history of the events. And this is what proposed as that twin cycle hypothesis by Roy Tyler. And the paper I sent to you was related to this. And this was presented in 2012 Banting lecture. Positive, what are the two cycles? One is the positive energy balance, which causes the liver to accumulate more and more fat. And this gets worsened because if the person has an insulin resistance, this happens very fast. And if the person has an insulin resistance, the skeletal muscle insulin resistance, there is going to be a slightly higher level of blood glucose and higher insulin secretion. And insulin's job is to store fat, and it stores in the liver. And this liver fat would, if the liver cell has large amount of fat to dispose, eventually the liver cell stopped responding to insulin and it synthesized more amount of triglycerol and glucose, continue to produce glucose. So this results in hyperglycemia and higher triglyceridemia. This both happens. And of course, if this initially, if the glucose gradually increases, we know a decade before the person is diagnosed with diabetes, the fasting glucose level gradually increases. And this also has increased amount of insulin is required to suppress that. So, and once higher amount of insulin comes, this would actually becomes a cycle. This would cause more amount of liver fat deposition. So this becomes one cycle. Higher insulin level, basically higher calories, more fat deposition in liver causes higher production of glucose, which causes more insulin secretion. So this one cycle, and this how this cycle relates to the second cycle is this triglycerides, which are synthesized by the liver, sent to everywhere. And mainly it goes, it should be going to the subcutaneous fat deposit. We all have, but one hypothesis is that everybody has a limitation of how much fat we can store in our subcutaneous tissue. So they call it as a personal fat threshold at the level of liver and at the level of subcutaneous tissue also. Not everybody could store the same amount of level. And if somebody has a limited capacity to store a lot of fat in the subcutaneous tissue, it goes into other cells. And the worst thing is it goes and settles down in the islets, the pancreatic islets, and the beta cells, in presence of higher level of triglycerol, starts responding to glucose. The first phase insulin response decreases. So we all know that first, the postprandial glucose gradually increases, and eventually even there is no first phase response in diabetic patients. So beta cells undergo dedifferentiation, and this will again increase the postprandial glucose, which will actually augment the first phase. So the both cycles. So once the cycle is triggered, they continue to spin under the influence of this positive calorie balance. So what is the advantage? Maybe, I know, a decade later, some other theory will come and modify our understanding. But what advantage this gives is that it tells us these cycles can be reversed. And that is what they have, past 10 years of research has been doing in this. People have done in that. And few of the important study I want to share. One is the counterpoint study, and other is the counterbalance study. And recently, this direct study in 2016, they started. This is a primary care-led weight management for remission of type 2 diabetes. So reversal is the term some researchers use, but this NHS started using the word remission. And they have been successful. Direct study results are continued to be published. They saw the significant number of people had gone euglycemia because of this low-calorie management, low-calorie diet. So this is from the image from the British Medical Journal. So after the success of this study, now the first slide I showed, that thousands of patients, that is 5,000 patients have been recruited for reversal of diabetes. Now they have taken seriously because the diabetes and COVID as combination is bad. And if we could do remission, NHS could be saved. That's what is their logic behind this. And this is a book by Roy Tyler, Life Without Diabetes. It's available for ₹2 in Amazon. You can read about it. I have a few more slides just to show what other thing happened in the past decade. We now understand much more about the pancreatic islet plasticity, islet cell plasticity. That's what it's called. So previously we thought that the beta cell function was permanently or irreversibly lost in diabetic patient, but that was not the case. This is the insulin sensitive non-diabetic patient who have this light red cell. This is the beta cell. They have a particular proportion of alpha, beta, and other cells. A insulin resistant pre-diabetic stage would have a hypertrophy and hyperplasia of beta cells. There is large number of beta cells, but at the time of diagnosis, the beta cells undergone a dedifferentiation and transdifferentiation. And you can see that in a diabetic patient, the number of beta cells number is decreased and the cells are also become small. But now we know that it's not absolute lost. There is something called islet plasticity. People have been working on all these things. And this the beta cells undergo dedifferentiation. Some of the beta cells have become alpha cells, and there are cells which do both the function of releasing glucagon and insulin, called as alpha plus beta cells. And when we reverse this problem of increased fat deposit in the pancreas, the beta cell recover, the number improves, and the insulin secretion comes back to normal in many patients. And this is the path by which beta cell, people are working, whether the alpha cell could become a delta cell, or there are some multipotent progenitors, or there are other cells, ductal cell, acinar cell, many things could become transdifferentiated into a beta cell, and beta cell number and function could recover after removing all the toxicity, the glucotoxicity and the lipotoxicity. If it is removed, pancreas recovers. And there is one more interesting development I saw, is that we know that type 2 diabetes is a heterogeneous disorder. There are people who develop complication very early, and somebody would go into early complication. We cannot predict these things easily. So there is one study, this is a large scale data analysis which they have done, and found 5 different forms of type 2 diabetes itself based on age and glutamate decarboxylase antibodies, BMI, HbA1c, and HOMA2 beta function and insulin resistance. They identified 5 different subgroups who have a different progression rate of the disease, and how they develop complication are different. We could actually potentially intervene different groups differentially, though there is no guidelines regarding this yet. But this is what has happened a couple of years ago, and it was being confirmed in few other countries also. It was originally done in Sweden, and a couple of other countries also have tried this hypothesis. And yes, everywhere these different subtypes which we can identify, there is a potential to target these groups differentially, which could, the next WHO classification could feature some of these things. Already this hybrid variety is known, the autoimmune type, and type 2 is there. And another important missing piece we found in the last decade is we know that exercise improves glycemic our glycemic profile, isn't it? So we always know that one reason said was at the level of skeletal muscle starts more uptake when we are doing exercise, and many other reasons were found. But one hormone we found, new hormone, it's called irisin, which is secreted by the skeletal muscle in response to exercise, and it improves glycemic profile, and it has an anti-diabetic function in different cells. Of course, every hormone, new hormone discovered, there is a lot of excitement, which happened with adiponectin, resistin, and there is excitement with irisin. I hope something we get out of it. So now our understanding, I reframed this. I think I picked from somewhere and I reframed it. So diabetes is a disorder of prolonged positive calorie balance leading to fatty liver and fatty pancreas. So what the advantage of definition is that now we know that the major problem is calorie balance and fat deposition, and not the insulin resistance or the insulin deficiency, which are reversible, which are actually the complications of the original problem. So in the center stage, in the beginning of the year, we will put this prolonged positive calorie balance. And this brings hope of reversal and remission, whichever they define, for diabetic patient. Thank you for listening. Any questions, please?
Yeah, it is open for discussion. I saw some one question by Dr.